Okay, looks like I'm not audible. Why does it happen daily? Yeah, I know. Hello, am I audible now? Okay, thanks, guys. Okay, so there are still people coming in, so let's just wait for a while. Okay, so I think we can get started. So, what I'm going to do now is like I'm going to recap whatever we discussed yesterday. Then I will ask if there are any questions from you. I will make a few announcements and then, that's how we will do today's class. Okay, so let's continue from where we left off yesterday. So, what's happening? Okay. All right, I think there are sufficient number of people here, so let's start. Okay, so let's just continue from yesterday where we had left off. Okay, so what we did yesterday was, sorry, there are a few more people coming in. I don't know why it asks me to admit. All right. Oh, I see. I see. So maybe we need to announce that they should join in from their IIT ID. All right. Thanks for that info. I will make an announcement. Everyone, just keep your side muted, okay, so that there is no noise. So, if you have questions, of course, by all means, unmute and ask. All right, so I think there are quite a lot of people here. Okay, all right, few more people are trying to. All right, continuing from yesterday, so what we were yesterday trying to do, we were trying to understand axioms of probability, right? So this is what we were trying to study yesterday. So what we did before that, we really had to understand what is meant by a sample space. We had to understand what is a sample space, what is an event, and then what is a probability law, right? So I remember yesterday that there were a few questions, so we will try to address from the point that we were yesterday, and then we will move on from there. So let's look at a few experiments. So all this is because what we w sample space, remember, it was having like coverage, which means this is collectively exhaustive. Right? And what we also had was mutually exclusive. Okay. So now, yesterday we had a few questions about the sample space itself. So let's look at a few more examples and let's try to understand that first. And then again, we will recollect all the axioms of probability. And I think this part is so important that it is worthwhile going through it a little slowly, because later on, once you get an understanding of this, things will become much easier. Okay, so let us look at a few experiments. So let's say experiment one. So what we are doing here is there is a single coin, so single coin, okay, which is tossed twice. So what that means, you do take the coin, you toss it once, note the outcome. So let's say let's write that. First toss, then note the outcome. Okay, then the second thing is do a second toss and note the outcome. Now, so this is an easy experiment, right? You have a single coin which you repeatedly twice, toss it twice. And since the coin, imagine like if this is an IPL coin, it shouldn't be that the first and the second coin are related in some, the tosses are related in some way. So sometimes team A will win, sometimes team B will win, right? So here, if you want to look at the sample space omega, remember this is pronounced as omega. So here, the sample space omega, what you do is you look at what is the first coin toss outcome, and then you look at what is the second coin toss outcome, and you list all possible outcomes so that you get coverage and you get mutual exclusive. So what are the possible outcomes? So you can have tail-tail, you can have tail-head, you can have head-tail, then you can have head-head. Okay. So this is the sample space for first experiment. Okay, so this is when you take a single coin and you do the toss twice. So this is experiment one. I hope this is easy enough, so nobody should have any problems here. So please interrupt me if this experiment one is not clear. So meanwhile, if there are no questions, let's do the second experiment. So now what we have is we have two coins. Okay. Which are distinguishable. So imagine that the first coin. So imagine that the first coin is a red coin. So what you have is a two distinguishable coins. First coin is a red coin. So what you have done is you have painted the coin with a fine thin paint of red. Okay, and the second coin is a blue coin. So this is going to be first coin. We are going to call this as the first coin, and this is what we are going to call it as the second coin. So now, when you have this experiment again, the omega is straightforward. It is going to be whatever was before, which is tail tail, tail head, head tail, head head. Right? Because you can distinguish each of the outcomes. Now, third experiment is a little tricky. So third experiment, what happens is, so you are not really seeing the coin tosses yourself. So somebody does the coin toss for you in a room which you don't have access to. So what I mean to say is hidden coin tosses. So what that means is someone is doing these coin tosses, two of them. Let us assume that they are doing a single coin twice. So what means is, so single coin is tossed twice. But what you are being told, so they do the coin tosses, but they will come and tell you how many heads were obtained. Okay, so it is the same thing, but here you don't really see the coin toss yourself. Someone is going to tell you after the tosses are done, they are going to tell you how many heads were observed. So your omega will essentially be two heads or one head or zero heads. So what I think the whole point of this entire exercise that we are discussing right now is to understand that the sample space depends upon how you specify your experiment. Is that okay? Yesterday, a lot of you had questions around this. So those of who had question last time, are you understanding how this is specified? It all depends upon how you say the words of the experiment. Are there any questions here? Okay, so that's, yeah, go ahead. It won't be, because you know the within the room, the way we are doing the coin toss is that the same coin is being twice. So what that means is the probability that you get two heads will be 1/4. So this is relatively rare, whereas the probability that this happens will be 1/4. This will be 1/2. So in all of the other cases, as you rightly predicted, since it's an IPL coin, all of this will be 1/4. Okay. And now, since we are doing the two coin tosses in a room, actually one head can be obtained in two ways. These are the two ways that internally it could have happened. But since you don't see the two ways clearly, you only know how many heads were obtained, you have to add them up. Does that answer your question? Okay. All right. Okay, so first thing is the coins that are being tossed, they are like fair coins. So let's write that down. So what we are doing is a fair coin toss. Okay, so fair means getting a head and getting a tail has the same probability. Okay, which is like equal chances of getting head as well as tails. Now when you are doing two coin tosses, okay, see, even though you don't know how the tosses gave you the number of heads, you can tell how can it come. Like for getting two heads, right? What is the how many ways can that happen? The first coin has to be heads, and the second coin has to be heads. So this is the only way this can happen. Okay. Whereas for getting one head, you can have the first coin to be head, the second coin has to be tail, or you can have first coin to be tail and the second coin can give a head. So this is how this will happen. And finally, this is for the last one, you have to have two tails. Now, even though you don't see this, this is not what you are seeing. What you are seeing is number of heads. So someone will tell you, if this happens, they will tell you two heads. If this happens, they will tell you one head. Okay, now each of this outcome will be 1/4, 1/4. Because of symmetry, each of this outcome will be 1/4, 1/4, 1/4. So now getting one heads, there are two ways in which it can happen. So that's why it will be 1/4 + 1/4 equal to 1/2. Does that answer your question? Okay. Don't worry, it is not too complicated. It's actually simple. All I'm trying to do is just look at several examples so that you understand how to write down your sample space. Okay, we will look at a few more examples and that it will become even more clear. Okay, so let's do that. So let me just make some space for me. So yeah, so now let's look at one more experiment. So let's call this as experiment 4. So now here what you are doing is like you are doing basically a secret exit poll. Okay, let me just describe this a little bit. Secret exit poll. What you do is you randomly pick 100 voters. Okay. And then each of the voters will anonymous ballot. So they are going to tell you what this means is anonymous opinion is given. Okay, so there are 100 people. Let's say there are two candidates, candidate A, then there is B candidate. Okay, and then third one is none of the above. Okay, so then fourth choice is these three are enough. Let's assume that these 100 voters have these three choices. So now when you do a secret exit poll like this, what will be the sample space? Can someone tell me? So how do we write the sample space? Shall I give one example? Okay, so these are but there are 100 voters, right? So what you can have is like 0 for candidate A, 0 for candidate B, 100 for nota. That is one way it can happen. Or next you can have 0 for candidate A, 1 for candidate B, 99 for nota, and so on. These are all the possible ways in which this can happen. Okay, shall I write a few more? So let's say 0 2 98, and then it can go on all the way till you have 0 100 0, and then you have to write all possible ways, and finally maybe it will end with 100 0 0. So basically, since you are doing this anonymously, you don't know how each of these voters have actually cast their vote. All you know is how many of votes are cast in favor of A, how many of the votes are cast in favor of B, how many of the votes are cast in favor of nota. Is that okay? I'm not talking about the probability. I'm not saying that this will happen with some probability and all. That is not the point of this. All I wanted to say at this point is, like, I wanted to give you another example of a sample space. Since there was some confusion yesterday, hopefully this should give you some more clarity. Is there any question here? Okay, good. So let's look at one more experiment. So remember, we have not yet started speaking about this probability yet. We are just trying to understand sample space because there were some issues yesterday. So now let's try it. Yeah. Yes, that you can have if you knew who voted for what. So that means, like, if there are 100 people and you really know how they have voted, so then you can have a sample space with one position for each 100 voters. That could be if you knew that. Does that make sense, Siddharth? If you knew it, you can write it like that. But since you don't know it, you can only show the count. Since it's anonymous, right? You can't see how each person has voted. All you know is the aggregate. See, when you have elections in India, do you really know how each person has voted? Yeah, so that is what. So because it is an anonymous hidden ballot, right? So that same way. Yeah, what are the three elements? What is the first element? Tell me. How many people, number of people, number of votes for A. Okay, what is the second element? Yeah. Yeah, okay. Let's assume that's what it is. Yeah, go ahead. Okay. So you mean A wins, you are saying A wins, B wins, nota wins. Is that what you're saying? This suppose, let us say one person voted for nota and let's say let's say zero voted for nota and then you had 50-50. What will, what, who wins now? Siddhant, do you see the problem? Okay, so you can specify the way you like, but you should ensure that there is like you get all the answers possible. Okay, so it's up to you if you design the experiment in such a way that whenever there is a clash, A wins. Suppose you can do that. So that will be also a possible omega. So the choice of, yeah. Okay. Okay, so you can have A wins, B wins, and then you can say tie. You can have it. I mean, see, the design of sample space depends upon the experiment. Suppose, let us say this exit poll was conducted by an agency who is only going to tell you whether A wins, B wins, NOTA wins, or tie, then of course that will be the sample space. Now, what I am telling you is that the agency who does this will not tell you who each person voted, but they will tell you the collected numbers. Like just the way Election Commission of India does, right? It tells you how each candidate got, isn't it? So that is my experiment. So I can design that experiment in that way. But if you want, this is going to be experiment 4A, where you can have just four outcomes in the omega. That is also possible. But it is just that it's a different experiment. Does that answer your question? All right. Okay, so that's good. So I hope the idea of sample space is clear. So let's try to move on a little bit and try to understand more about events. So towards that, let us look at an example and try to look at what is meant by an event. Okay, so let's look at so please understand that right now we are giving you very simple, almost silly looking examples, but soon there will be really practical examples that will be coming in, okay, as you go through this course. The point of giving simple examples is so that you understand the concepts, and later on you will see that there are plenty more examples. So it is never that we will go and do a coin toss and really find something useful out of it. That may not really happen. But what these examples are just for making you understand, okay? So let's look at a simple example again. So this example is now two dice throw. So let's now what we will do with this example is we will now look at probability. We will look at events. So we are going to make the next step. So far we have talked about sample space. Now we are going to make the next step, wherein we are bringing in some more elements of the axioms. Okay. So there are two dice throw. Each dice, if you remember, like if you have played Ludo or things like that, it looks like this, right? So you will have some numbers. So this could be right. So this is a dice. So if you do two of the dice, so there are two dice. So one is, let's say, this one, a blue die, and then there is a red one. Okay, and then you are going to do two dice throw here. So since these dice are colored, you can distinguish it. So we will call the blue one as the first, this one as the second. Okay, so now our sample space will be just a big collection. Let me write that because it is going to be useful. So we will write 1 comma 1, 1 comma 2, 1 comma 3, 1 comma 4. Okay, I'm going to run out of space, so we will make some space. Oops. One comma 5, 1 comma 6. Okay, then you will have 2 comma 1, 2 comma 2. So I'm going to write this all, okay, just so that we can talk about this a little bit in detail. 3 comma 1. So 5,3, 5,4, 5,5, 5,6, and finally 6,1, 6,2, 6,3, 6,4, 6,5, 6,6. Okay, very good. So this is all the sample space. Okay, so I have not missed any, right? Because the first dice can be 1 to 6 and the second one can also be 1 to 6. There are totally 36 outcomes. So the cardinality of this particular sample space is 36. And due to symmetry, cardinality of any of these points, so let's say probability of getting 2,3, this outcome, okay, probability of getting 2,3. So I'm writing this, okay, this 2 doesn't look very legible. Let me just erase and write. So what I'm saying is this outcome space has 36 elements. There is symmetry. Both the coins, both the dice are identical. So because of symmetry, what we have is probability of getting any particular outcome, let us say 2,3, is going to be 1 over 36. Okay. So this is the probability on each of the elements of the sample space. So this is called sample space or omega. So probability of getting any of these, each of these individual item, any one of them, is going to be 1 over 36. Is this point clear to everybody? Okay, good. So now let us try to look at more complicated events. So as I told you yesterday, event is a subset of omega. So now what are all the subsets that we can consider? Let's look at event one, a simple event. So event one is basically a set of all, this is what I'm writing here is small omega belonging to capital omega. So this is your, you'll learn this in discrete math. So this is a way of writing the sets. I'm sure you have learned during your school. So basically what I'm saying is we are looking at all the outcomes here such that the sum of the outcomes, like outcomes, is 6. So that's what I'm going to look at. So now, which are all the outcomes that gives a 6? So let's list them. So let me just copy this into a next slide. Okay, we will look at this once more. Okay, so now what we are saying is, like, let us look at the two dice throw again, and now E1 is the set of, or the event that is comprising of all the outcomes from omega such that the sum, it sums to 6. So which are all the places that sums to 6? So can someone just help me out so that I can underline that outcomes? Yes. Yeah, thanks. So 3,3,4,2,5,5,1. Okay, so what even, so probability of even, let us try to understand what it will be. So probability of even is going to be probability of basically these elements 5,1,4,2,3,3,2,4,1,5. Now this is where our first second law comes in. Now what we are saying is each of these outcome, okay, if you look at in terms of set theory, each of these outcome are disjoint, right? It's mutually exclusive. You cannot have 5,1 and 4,2 simultaneously. Okay, so we can write this using the law that we discussed. So P of A union B, when, remember this law, so A intersection B is empty. So P of A union B is P of A plus P of B. So now if you take these two as A and all of this together as B, they are disjoint, right? Phi 1 and this set and this set, they are disjoint. So we can write this as P of phi comma 1 plus P of the rest of them, which is 4, 2, 3, 3, 2, 4, 1, 5. Is this okay? Anybody has any questions for this first step? So this is where we have used one of the axioms of probability, which is, I think, axiom 2 or 3. I think this was 3. Okay, so what that says is, when you have disjoint events, the probability that any of these events can happen, either one of the events can happen, is the sum of individual events. So if you look at the set that is comprising of a single element phi 1 and the set that is comprising of 4 2 3 3 2 4 1 5, they are disjoint. There is nothing that is common between A and B. So you can write the probability by dividing into 2. So is that step clear? Okay, so now if that is clear, we can continuously do these steps like this. So phi 1, now I will take out 4 2. Once I take out 4 2, I will be left with the rest of it. 3 3, okay, 2 4, 1 5. So like that, I can keep on extracting one by one all the elements. And now each of these elements that I told you before is 1 over 36. So this will be 5 over 36. Okay. So what and all axioms that we have seen, let's just recall. So there are three axioms. The first one is probability of any event has to be non-zero. So this is called non-negativity. Okay. The second one is... is the probability of the entire sample space has to be 1. This is the second law. The third one that we just looked at it is if A comma B are events, okay, such that A intersection B is empty, what we have, the third axiom, it says P of A union B, which means either A or B happening, is equal to P of A plus P of B. Okay. So these are the three axioms. We have seen how we can use the axioms with this example. Are there any questions here? So this is kind of important point, which is important for you to understand. So if you have any questions, please let me know. Okay, so now what we are going to do, so what you realized here, if you see this step carefully here, right, even though we had five elements, we were able to write it in terms of, by repeatedly applying three, we were able to go from two of A and B disjoint to N. So now let's try to write 3A. Okay, so let us say if A1, A2, A3, let's say there are n of them, okay, such that AI intersection AJ is equal to empty when I is not equal to J. So I'm extending whatever three law, I'm extending it to multiple such pieces. So now what we have is P of A1 union A2 union A3 union A4 up to AN, finite number of them. This is going to be sum of P of A1 plus P of A2 plus P of A3. So from 2 we can get to any finite number, right? Is this point clear? How we do this? So we group them together. So we write A1 as A and the rest of them we write it as B. Okay. Then now we are back to 2, that for which there is an axiom. We apply that axiom once and then you keep applying, you can get this. So that's what we did here, right? So we applied this axiom repeatedly, and then we could get for this kind of a situation where there were five elements. Are there any questions up to this point? Okay, so now since we have reached here, let's take the next step. Okay, before that, yeah, let's do the next step anyway. So what we are going to do from step 3A, we are now going to go to a further more complicated step. So before that, let's look at one more experiment. So let's call this as experiment 6. Okay, so now this experiment is basically having an omega, okay, which can take values 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, all the way to infinity. You can take any value in omega. So this is this. Now what I need to do is I need to tell you what is the probability of this, right? So let me draw what is called as probability mass function. Someone has a question? Okay. Okay, so what I'm going to do is I'm going to write a diagram of what is the probability of each of these outcome. So one happens with probability half. Okay. Two happens with probability 1/4. Three happens with probability 1/8, and then so on. Okay, now we don't even know if, so if you have to check basically probability of omega, what is this? If you have to check, it's basically going to be probability of 1 plus probability of 2 plus probability of 3 and so on, right? So now since we have specified it like this, we also know that this is half plus 1/4 plus 1/8 plus so on. Okay, so now what does this sum to? So all of you have learnt what is the sum of geometric series, right? So when you have a plus ar plus ar square, okay, and like this, and r is less than 1, what you have is the sum is going to be a by 1 minus r, right? So if you use that idea here, a is half, so 1 minus r, r is also half, so this becomes 1. Okay, so now we have effectively shown that p of omega is 1. Sorry, let me, so is this fine? Do you see any problem with this argument? Is there anyone who sees a problem with this argument? So let me repeat. So what you have here is an experiment which omega can take values 1, 2, 3, 4, 5 and so on. What we have done is we have written the diagram for this experiment in this following manner. On the x-axis, we have all the points that omega has. I have shown only 4 of them, where we have written what is the probability of each of the outcomes. So p of 1 is half, p of 2 is 1/4, p of 3 is 1/8. Now, if you want to look at p of omega, each of this is mutually exclusive. So we can write it as a sum from the law number 3a, right? And then that is what we did. And now using the sum to infinity of arithmetic series, we have got this. So my question is there any problem in the argument that we made? Is there any problem here? Okay, so that is true, but what you said is possible, but my experiment is such that I have designed the experiment such that 1 takes half, 2 takes 1/4, 3 takes 1/8. You can have an experiment where 3 can have 0 probability and 4 can have 1/8 plus 1/16. That is possible, but in my experiment I have fixed this as the probability. See, it depends upon the physics of the experiment, right? So if you are doing a coin toss, the probabilities are equally likely. That's how it is. If it is a biased coin, something else will happen. Okay, so your question is valid. What you are asking is, how did I fix these numbers? And I'm saying these numbers I just fixed just like that out of thin air for making a point. I know it can be different, but right now I've just picked this number. Is that fine, Siddhant? Okay, so that is fine. What he said is correct. Decent. I mean, it's a valid question. But my question is there any problem in these steps that we have done? Is there anything wrong in sum to arithmetic series? Is that okay? Everyone is convinced with that? Or is there any problem in this step? Anywhere do you see any other problems? Okay, so let me just tell you, it's a little difficult to see, it's a little bit hidden. So what we have here, unit 3a, is what is finite additivity. Okay, so 3a is finite additivity. So you can only do it for finitely many numbers. So we cannot use it to do this step, because this is, oh sorry, so this step here, this is going to be infinite additivity, right? So this is called countable additivity. It's infinite, so that is something we cannot do, but that is why we have an axiom for it. So what we are going to say is that if a1, a2 and so on till infinity are mutually disjoint, which means ai intersection aj is empty. Okay, they are mutually disjoint for I not equal to j. Then what you have is sum p of union I equal to 1 to infinity of ai. So this notation is might be something that is very new for you. So what this means is that I'm writing a1 union a2 union so on. Okay, a1 union a2 union so on and till infinity. I'm just doing the union of all of them. This is going to be I equal to 1 to infinity of p of ai. So this is now a new axiom that I'm introducing, because this is necessary for cases such as this. Okay, because all you had in 3a was finite. Okay, a1, a2, a3 up to an. N is a fixed number, maybe 100, maybe 1000, maybe 1 million, but it is a fixed number. So union, when you are doing this from 2 to finite, it's possible to do, but from 2 to infinity, it is not possible to do. That is why we need to have a separate axiom for this, which is this. Now, once we have 3b, this step is fine. So this step is coming from 3b. Okay, so this is called as countable additivity. Let me write this. Countable additivity. All right, so that is one step. Now there is another. Yeah. That is correct. Since it collects everything in the sample space, it has to be one, but we don't know what it sums to, right? I just specified some numbers here. So we are checking whether it sums to one. If it sums to one, our experiment is all right. Our sample space is all right. Okay, yes, you are right. Since it, so here, for example, 3b, right? There is no reason that union of all of this is the entire omega. It's not necessary. Okay, let me give you an example so that you understand when that can happen. So who was it that asked me this question, just so that I can interact? Advay? Okay, so Advay, so let us try to look at this same experiment here, experiment 6, and let me ask you, what is the probability that you get a even outcome? So what are all the things that will come here, Advay? So let's be step by step. So you'll have P4 plus P2 plus P4 plus P6, right? Right, Advay? So this will be P2 will be 1 by 4 and P4 will be 1 by 16 and so on. Okay, so now here in this step we have used 3B. Is that okay, Advay? Now, does that sum to 1? No, right? So it's not always necessary that it will sum to 1. So this will be 1 over 3. Yeah. Okay, so very good. So I think we have covered a lot of ground today. So these are all very important things that we are discussing here. And many of these things don't get very clear. So I will just spend another. Okay, I don't think I have too much time. So, okay, so let me just spend some more time. About 5 minutes or so talking about a little bit more from here. So let's just write all of these laws in a new sheet. Okay, so and then we will look at it. So what you have for a probability is excuse me. So what you have is for defining a probability experiment, what you need to define, okay, is you have to define a sample space omega. Then you need to define events, okay. Events E are basically subsets of omega, okay. And then you have the laws. There are three laws. The first law is P of A is greater than or equal to 0. This is non-negativity. The second law is P of omega is equal to 1. And the third law is if. So now we are going to combine all the things that we saw. We saw that countable additivity, right? The infinitely many people were there. We wrote it together, right? So that was countable additivity. We are only going to write that. I will tell you why. Okay, so suppose you have events E1, E2, E3, and so on, such that EI intersection EJ is equal to empty. Okay, now probability of union I equal to 1 to infinity of EI is going to be summation I equal to 1 to infinity of probability of EI. Okay, now we don't need to write finite additivity. Why is that? So let us see how you can get finite additivity from 3. So let us say we want to prove that P of A union B is equal to P of A plus P of B. Okay, and let us suppose that P of what is this? P, sorry. A intersection B is empty. So now from countable additivity, how do we get to finite additivity? That is the question. So to do this, what you can do is you can choose first two sets A and B as it is, and then you can choose all the empty sets. Okay, when you have this P of union of all these elements A union B union empty set union empty set union empty set, all of this I keep doing this. This is going to be they are all disjoint, right? If you take B intersection empty set is empty set, so this is going to be P of A plus P of B plus P of empty set plus P of empty set plus P of empty set, and all of this till infinite time. Okay, so left hand side will be P of A union B, and right hand side will be P of A plus P of B. Okay, because P of empty set is 0. Why is that? So let's understand why P of empty set is 0. Okay, so that is easy to do. So now you take omega. Okay, omega and empty set. So omega intersection empty set is empty set. Okay, we know that P of omega P of omega union empty set is P of omega plus P of empty set. Okay, so this is, this left hand side is P of omega itself. So this becomes P of omega is P of omega plus P of empty set. Okay, so that means P of empty set is zero. So what did we do here? So what we got is, like, from countable additivity, we are able to get finite additivity. That is the point. Okay, so I think this covers some of the important, most fundamental aspects about probability. So let me know if you have any questions from today or the last class. So let's use this 10 minutes to discuss some of the questions that you may have. Yes, anyone? Okay. Yes. Yes, let me see if I can pull that up. Let's go there. I don't know where it is. So let's see. 8C, 1 minute. Not here. Yes. This is not omega. This is basically a subset of omega. So it's an event. So omega is basically all the possible outcomes that can happen. That is omega. Okay. So that is the sample space. Events are basically some elements of omega for which you may be allowed to ask what is the probability of such an event. Okay. Is that all right? Is a very good, your doubt clear? How about do you understand countable additivity to finite additivity, how we went? Yeah, please go ahead. Yeah. Yes. Why is this? Why are we using this? Ah, right. Very good. Very good. Okay, I think we cannot condense countable additivity. So let's just keep countable additivity and finite additivity together. Or we will do one thing. We will have P of omega equal to phi, and we'll also say P of empty set is zero. So that is the way to fix this. It's a valid question. So let me say what Advay said. See, basically, to do this step, okay, to do this step, we are under trouble, right? What we assumed here is we could do finite split like this. That we cannot do, because in our reformed law, we only have countable additivity. Okay, so I'm sorry to get into these details, but these are some of the details which mathematicians get into, and this is important to sort it out. So this is not a valid argument. This is not valid. However, we can fix this argument very easily by adding. So why is P of omega 1? Because we took that as an axiom. We can also add P of phi equal to 0. That also we can add as an axiom. This is easy to understand, right? The entire sample space, what's the probability of that happening? That is 1. Nothing happening. What's the probability nothing happens? That's going to be 0. So that is, I think, the way to fix this. Advay, is that okay? How about everybody else? Everyone comfortable with what we are discussed so far today? Countable additivity along with the first axiom to prove it. Okay, yeah. So I guess you can try when this is going to happen. Yeah, we don't know when the college is going to open, Himanshu. It's a little bit trouble. See, the pace that we are using today in the class is, I would like to go faster, but it's very difficult to keep everyone in touch. Yes. What is the coverage? So basically, in the sample space, we should collect every possible outcome. So basically, what I'm trying to say, the sample space consists of mutually exclusive and collectively exhaustive. So what that means is, so collectively exhaustive means you don't leave anybody behind. So this is what is meant by the coverage. Every element is covered. Every possible outcome that you can expect from the experiment is handled. So that is what I meant by coverage. It's basically another term for collectively exhaustive. Okay, Umang? All right, so, so sounds good. So what we will do, I will make an announcement for a small assignment around the topic that we discussed. So I will make an announcement tomorrow. It's going to be very easy, and just it will just test some basic things. Now I know this assignment and quizzes are a little painful, but this is the only way in which we can ensure that you learn something. And since this is such an important topic, I really have no way around this. So I was planning to also have a quiz, but I think we will postpone the quiz for some time. So I will make some announcements tomorrow about what assignments we are doing. And yeah, so I think that's about it. We are towards the end of the class. So if there are any questions, please let me know. Otherwise, we will break for today. Yeah. Okay, sure. Tell me. I really don't know how I can do that. How can I do? Yeah, if you can present, do present. I don't know if it will allow me to allow you. Okay, try. Okay. Everyone, you can see it, right? Is it working? Yeah, go ahead. Yes. Yes. Okay. No, it is not all the population. North Goa has much more people. It has let's say 10 lakh people. Okay. So now, based on the budget that you had, what you did was you came up with a population that you wanted to quiz. You wanted to do a sample. You chose a sample size of 10,000. It's not that the entire South Goa is done. It's just that you have finished only 1,000, but already the trends are very clear. So you don't have to do for the complete budget. You don't have to waste all the money just because you have the money. That's what I was trying to say. Then you have to say the elections are non-conclusive. You have to hold this seat that you are looking at is saying that this is not very conclusive. You cannot conclude anything. Any way it can go, right? So these kind of constituencies are actually what will be one with 100 or 200 or things like that. So that you cannot predict. You cannot do for everybody. So we will learn how to do this, okay? So at some point you will learn this, not to worry. Okay, so Rishabh, what's your question? Yes, very good. So how do we know when to stop? That's your question. So basically probability theory gives you tools to say confidently that just by 10,000 you can predict for 1 lakh. It will happen. There is no question about it. You will do experiments and you will check that this happens, okay? So it's not that we are telling something in air. So it is going to be absolutely conclusive. So we will see that when we learn a topic called as central limit theorem. So at that time, you will know when we are saying, we will say with confidence. Okay, so yes, you can tell based on opinion polls. You can, if the opinion polls are done well, you can actually predict the outcome of an election. Yes. Is that okay, whoever asked me that question? Who was that? Okay, so for that, you need to understand the statement of central limit theorem. Then you will be able to tell what is the difference that is enough to conclude. Yes. So that for that we have to learn some more things. So, but you can tell, that is all I'm saying. Okay, we will learn that, not to worry. So it comes there. Okay. All right, I don't want to keep anybody more than the designated time. Everyone will get fatigued. So I think it was a very interesting class today as well. So I will hopefully the recording has happened well. I will upload it in YouTube and I will share the links. I will make some announcements. And yeah, so I will also give you some lectures to watch in the week. And let's continue from where we left off next week on Monday. Okay? All right, guys. Thank you very much. Have a good evening. Bye-bye.